If there's one best tip that I can give you on how to declutter your home as a working mom, it's this. Hi friends, I'm Simply Sherry and I help you have less stress and more peace by creating a home you love. So this is the best tip that I have for you. You're busy, you have priorities, you have responsibilities. Kids have so many things going on. You are dedicated to your marriage. You are committed to your friendships. You care for your family. And so everything seems like a priority or is important, right? And it is. So this is the thing that's going to help you with your time and your energy to keep a decluttered home. And that's to establish a decluttering routine that involves the whole family. You cannot do it by yourself because you're not the only one who lives in the house. Everybody else lives there, so we all take ownership of our home. It's crucial to have a decluttering routine because it has three very impactful benefits, and one of them is it helps you set priorities. With a consistent routine, you prioritize high traffic areas or areas that have been neglected or areas that are more of a concern for you in wanting it to be consistently decluttered. For example, you may want your entryway, living room, dining room, for how it's set up, that you want that area to always be decluttered. So that is for my house. When you enter, you're in the entryway, right away, straight ahead, you see the living and dining room, and then to the left is the hallway. So that's an area that I prioritize, has to always be decluttered, always tidied, always clean, because that's where I welcome guests, whether they're invited or they're surprise guests. For you, it might be the family room because you spend a lot of time in there, or every afternoon when the kids come home from school, you're home from work, the kitchen table is a priority for you. So while you're cooking in the kitchen or preparing stuff in the kitchen, you are able to watch your kids while they're doing homework at the kitchen table. That might be priority for you. And so you want that space to be conducive to the things that you'll be doing there. As someone who's been homemaking or homekeeping, whatever you want to call it, for decades, and as a professional organizer who has decluttered and organized my own home, as well as my clients, helping them declutter and organize theirs, I have a suggested order as far as what areas to prioritize in your decluttering routine. So the first area are the main areas. For example, the kitchen, the family room, the playroom, the landing zone. These are areas that are high traffic. They're used every day. And when someone is in your house, whether it's you or guests, they see these areas. Those are the main areas. Number two are the hidden areas. Those spaces could be like your closet, the laundry room, maybe even an office, whether you use it every day or you work from home, it's still only an area that you use. And then when guests come over, you can close the door. Those are hidden areas. And then lastly, the third area are storage areas. That's the attic, maybe a room in your basement, the garage, a shed, right? Or a den or an extra room where you've thrown everything in there, right? That's a whole nother story that we can address another time. But those are the three areas: main area, hidden area, storage area, areas or spaces, right? So what I want you to do is to list out every room and closet in your home, include the garage, maybe the attic above the garage, the basement, whatever you have, okay? List those rooms, and to the right of it, is this a main area, a hidden area, or a storage area? And then from there, you take all the main and you put it in one column, all the hidden in another column, and then the remaining storage in one column. So now you're going to look at that and say, if you are, you know, completely overwhelmed, you don't know where to start, you start with the main area, okay? Don't start with your closet, because that's a hidden area. Or if you think your closet is a main area because you are in and out of that space every single day and is driving you absolutely bonkers, okay, then make that your main area. Personally, that's not how I would categorize it, but again, you're not organizing my house. you're organizing, you're decluttering your own home. So whatever makes sense in your mind, I always say organize by how you think. So if that's how you think, then that your closet will be a main area. Another benefit of establishing a decluttering routine is that it helps you create habits. So for us, when I mentioned in my previous video that there were natural months of the year or times of the year that we decluttered. For example, when it was going to be the beginning of the school year, my kids were not given new clothes just because they wanted new clothes. They would have to donate a handful. Okay, they're not going to get a whole bunch of new clothes just because they donated everything they had. You know, obviously you understand the boundaries, right? But let's say they gave up about 5 pieces of clothing, you know, maybe 3 shirts, 2 pants that, you know, have seen better days or they're still good enough to donate, then they would let go of those and they could be replaced because they couldn't have overflowing closets, right? Another time would be right before Christmas. If they wanted stuff for Christmas, including toys, then we would have to go through, or they would go through things that they would want to donate. With the same principle, you know, they're not going to go donate all their toys so that they can get, you know, a whole bunch of new toys. So within limits, within reason. And so also involving the whole family, how it creates habits is that they know they do this together, right? It's not, oh, it's just mom who declutters and gets rid of everything, right? All of us do this together. Now, if you happen to be the one who has a harder time of letting things go, then that might be a little bit different, but I know I think all of us, my whole family, we had certain things that were easier to accumulate, whether it was clothes or shoes or books or headbands or Legos, you know, things like that. I feel like most people have like their thing that's a little bit harder to let go of or a little bit easier to keep collecting. So those are the things that we need to keep in check. But as a family, it created a habit where we knew together that this is how we wanted to live in our home, was to have decluttered spaces. And one way we created that habit was that I had like a 13 by 13 bin that you know you could get at the big box stores was right by the landing zone, because I had cubbies for my landing zone when my kids were growing up. So that was the donation bin, and it was literally labeled donations. So whenever they felt like it, if even if it wasn't the beginning of the school year or Christmas or those, you know, natural times of the year that we would declutter, they could declutter anytime. You know, they are not beholden to just that time of the year, right? They are free to let go of when they need to let go of anything, because we taught those principles of what should be and needs to be let go, right? And so we had this bin, and every Friday I would check it, right? Then I would bring it to Goodwill. I usually brought it at night so that there was no traffic, because my particular Goodwill always seemed to have traffic. And then I saw, as we, you know, I had taught my kids to do this, every so often they say, is the donation bin full? Because I have a bunch of stuff to let go of. So that was, you know, music to my ears. And then the third benefit is that it prevents accumulation, right? When you have a regular decluttering routine with your family, it makes it so that things don't accumulate, right? But if you do it this way and you bring stuff and bring stuff and bring stuff, it's gonna pile up, right? Where does it go? You only live in a certain amount of space, and it can only contain so much. And this was one of the other lessons I had taught my kids, was the container principle. So this one actually is for packing tape. And you could see, like, it's not full. It used to be kind of full, but we've done a lot of, when I moved my mom closer to me, we did a lot of packing. So I think I just haven't refilled it. So just imagine, so what you could do is just take a container, whether this lesson is for you or for your kids or for anybody, right? You take a container and you see, like, okay, there's two there. You could see right away what's in there, right? You could see that there's space. So, you know, you could see it from the side, so you're not deterred by something, you know, blocking that. So you can see, right? But you know that it only can contain a certain amount of packing tape if this is what it's for, Okay, so just imagine, so I told my kids, just imagine this is your room, okay? This is your space, right? And then we want to, you have your bed, okay? You have your dresser. Maybe you have some stuffed animals. You have your desk and chair. Okay, that's your closet with your toys. Okay, now you want to put more stuffed animals. Then you've got your clothes. And then you've got some more toys. And then you want extra pillows on your bed. You got a bean bag. Right? Do you get you get it, right? The more you fill it with stuff, there's a point where it's going to overflow. It doesn't fit. So then I would ask my kids, okay, do you like, obviously this is, where are you going to fit now? You're going to be like right there? Like you barely fit in your own room. And how does it feel? So when only a few things would be in there, I'd say, well, how does that make you feel? When now it's, halfway through, okay, how does that make you feel? Now when it's full, how does that make you feel? Does it make you feel stressed? Does it make you feel like, let me get out of here, I don't want to spend time in here? So then I did the same thing, the same principle with our home, right? So like I said, oh, here, let's fill the living room with a couch, with a chair, the dining table, whatever. And then I would just fill it and fill it and fill it. And I said, well, do you want to live in this space? Do you want me to do the same thing to our house? You know, it's just a bigger example of their room. So I hope that makes sense. You know, another, I don't know, what do you call that? Like a parallel or example you can use is like the gas tank, right? In the car, do you keep filling up the gas until the gas is overflowing out of, you know, the tank, and it's spilling all over the car, on your shoes, on your clothes? No, that's dangerous. You are forced to stop. That's why even that the gas has like an automatic stopper, because it's not good, right? It's not good for you. It's not good for the car. It's not good for the surrounding area. But we do that to our home. We just stuff it and stuff it. And it's not good. It's not good for you. It's not good for your home. It's not good for the area around it and the people that are in that area. So I hope that makes sense. That was a big lesson that I myself learned and that I taught my kids, and it just makes complete sense, the container principle. So I'm saying that because you can use those types of visual aids or learning or something. You know, you can come up with something. You know your kids better, you know your family better, you know yourself better. How will this resonate with them, with you as a family, that these are principles that you really take to heart, because it will last not just as their kids or you in this household, but as they move on. You know, my kids are now 20 and 25. They have my daughter's in the dorms. My son has his own apartment. And these are principles that I taught them growing up and that we stuck to, you know, that it was important for us as a family to live in an environment that was conducive to peace, that allowed us to breathe, right? Like example, here's an example. I let my bookshelves here breathe. It doesn't have to be filled. But hey, listen, if you love filled bookshelves with all the filled books, that's fine. But you can't fill up every area of your home, fill with everything from, floor to ceiling, and all within, in every nook and cranny in your home. It just doesn't work, you know. You're not going to feel good in your own home. And other things you can do is assign tasks. So if we were taking care of, let's say, the playroom, age-appropriate tasks, right? So my daughter would be, you know, she knew which toys go in which bin, so she would do that. But my son, maybe we would, because he's 5 years older, I would put a task more of, asking him if this certain bin, if we should keep it to be the Legos, or should it be like a broader category, or things like that. And another thing you could do is celebrate progress. Now, I think for us, it wasn't like we went and got ice cream because we decluttered the family room, right? Or we got rid of some board games that we were not playing with anymore. I more believed in enjoying our space. And, you know, example, if we did the pantry together, I mean, we would just look at it a few times and say, oh, that feels good. Me, a little bit more than that, probably 10 times. Them, a couple times, you know. And we would embrace it, like, okay. And I would ask questions like, okay, how do you feel? You know, what adjectives come to mind? So you want to connect. I think that was one of my philosophies, is I wanted to connect feelings and adjectives to a space when it's decluttered versus feelings and adjectives to things when we accumulate or we get, right? Because you naturally, you get that natural high of that dopamine hit when you get something new, like, you know, you get a new toy, a new dress, a new whatever, right? It always feels good. That's kind of natural. That's almost like you can't even stop that sometimes. But when you let go of things, you know, those are harder to attach good emotions to it. So I taught myself and I helped them with attaching good emotions to clean spaces, to freed up spaces, to decluttered areas, right? Let me know what you think about that. You know, it's something like I definitely want to discuss more in my YouTube membership that I'm launching. And if you want to see what you get as part of a member on my YouTube channel, check out the description below. I don't want to just talk about like just how-tos and what to do and three tips and hacks. You know, I was never really into like hacks. But even just giving tips, you know, I think what I really want to bring to the membership is really the mindset and the psychology of decluttering, of organizing, of really helping you be aware and self-aware of what works for you. Because not everything works for everybody, right? There are people where there is this very popular style of decluttering that, you know, people grabbed onto and they became minimalist. Right, but there are people who don't want to be minimalists, like me. I do not want to be a minimalist. I never tried to be one. I thought about it, but I realized, listen, I like to entertain. I have a whole shelf. I actually have three shelves of entertaining stuff, like shaping dishes, platters. I mean, because I can host 60 people in my home. I love throwing parties like that. And I'm not going to give that up by having four plates. Okay, so I was not going to be a minimalist. And so, you know, decluttering, organizing, tidying, maintaining your home, cleaning, life, you know, lifestyle, how you live in your space is different for everybody. You know, we have different expectations, different needs at different points in our lives, right? When I was a younger family, you know, I couldn't entertain 60 people, right? Like, who wants to do that? Like, I'm just trying to put, you know, cook dinner every night, let alone for 60 people. But I evolved, right? And so, anyway, that's something that I want to talk more in my membership community, is really helping you figure out what really resonates with you and how you are going to declutter, how you are going to organize, and, you know, continue with that. And even how are you going to teach these type of lessons, or the lessons you want to teach your kids as they're growing up? Because the benefits, you know, of, you know, we're just here to launch our kids, or to, you know, let them flap their wings. And it's just been amazing, you know, just seeing the results in their short, in just the short years that they've been out of the home, and seeing, you know, it just makes me proud. And I just want to share that with you guys. And I'm not saying that what I did will work for you, but again, it's part of the process of really learning what works for you and how that message hits you, how that technique, how that tip, how that, way of life, way of thinking has helped you, and then how that could possibly help your kids. So I'm totally into that, and I just want to move this channel, my channel, forward towards that. I make no apologies. I'm very, I feel like I have a great home. I've been blessed by a lot of company and friendships, and people have been blessed by the home and the hospitality that I've had, that I've shared, and that my husband and I have shared, and then my kids and I have shared. So anyway, I guess that's enough. Hold on, I have got one more surprise for you guys. Ah. Here's my surprise. Meet Zoe. Okay, if you guys have been part of my channel for a while, or for at least more than 2 years, I used to have Molly, my dachshund. We miss her very much. It's been 2.5 years. We actually adopted her. She passed. She had cancer. And, you know, I think 2 years, I just didn't want another dog. And then it's been 2.5. And I was like, my husband was like, you know, you can get a new dog if you want. I was like, sure, sure. And once in a while I would look, and I definitely wanted to adopt a dog. Well, one day, one morning, my husband brings Zoe home and he's like, meet Zoe. She had a different name, but we named her Zoe. And she's a Maltipoo. She was found all matted and dirty, walking around in the hot streets of Arizona. The county took her, someone brought her to the county. They kept her for a while. Nobody looked for her. Then they moved her to a place called Heidi's Village, which is more for like poodle type breeds. And somebody that my husband knows was fostering her. She texted a bunch of people, including my husband, asking if you want to adopt Zoe. So my husband was smitten by her from the beginning. She's super sweet, and she's my new companion. She's a Velcro dog, and she sits at my feet. So I just wanted to introduce her and let you know that maybe in the future videos, if I'm walking around my home, this is my new love. Okay? All right, guys. Well, if you want to see the whole series of how to maintain a clean and organized home, click the playlist, and I'll see you hopefully in the membership. Bye. Say bye. Bye. Woof woof.